In this video, spokesman for men and women that love them, this particular episode, I'm going into how an alpha could become betanized. And this is a strategic method that many women use, some consciously, some unconsciously, to betanize an alpha. And what I mean, women are initially attracted to men because of strength, because of dominance, because he's intelligent, because he's attractive, and because he's a provider. But once she lures him in and she's with him for a while, she attempts to betanize him. And many men are not aware of that. And if she betanizes him, what I mean by that is that she's trying to get him to conform to her ways. Women are naturally attracted to men that could actually attract other women. But once she's in a relationship with him, even though that he could attract other women prior to being with her, she will betanize him and say, well, you could only be with me now. You're only supposed to be with me. I would like you to do this way. That's an alpha that becomes betanized. And this is actually what happened in this particular situation. We have a woman in Sabrina who was struggling. She didn't have good credit. She ran into a guy who was an alpha. He was rearing his own children. He was pretty successful. He was a homeowner. He had great credit. She comes in. She's struggling. She's a single mother. Her credit's not great. She uses him for a come up. And then when I call her out on it, an elderly lady who's also almost 60, single, divorced, says, I feel as though you're attacking us. Why? Because I asked them questions that expose the folly. Listen in for yourselves.
So my thing is, here's a quick little story. So I've been married 8 years, right? When I first got with my husband, you know, obviously I was looking for a long-term relationship. I was by myself for about 8 years, right? Being independent, paying my own bills, blah, 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 right? Then I ended up finding a partner and, you know, he had two girls of his own and I had my daughter and I became into a blended family, right? Now, with that, he was looking for something about his own values as I was too. Now, he had good credit. He was a homeowner. He had a good job. He's with his job for 23 years now. He's stable, right? I was a single parent trying to figure out my own situation, get my credit under control, yada, yada, right?
See here, Sabrina's admitting that her credit wasn't great and she was a struggling single parent. Here was a guy that was well off, and you would discover that he had his own home. She comes into the relationship. She betanizes him because a home that he already had prior to the marriage, her name becomes on the title. So now she's saying, she's not even saying our home. She's saying my home. And I really challenge men to listen to women when they speak, because they will tell you exactly how they are thinking. But I have the insight and the ability to trigger certain things in people, and it, for whatever reason, exposing the truth infuriates them and they want to run. Proverbs 28:1, the wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous is as bold as a lion.
Right. Then I moved into his house and I became, you know, we said, okay, 50-50. That's how it became 50-50. And then as time goes on, I become tired. And I'm sure
Hold on a second. I just want to get the clear understanding. So you're saying when he moved in, he said things are going to be 50-50, meaning you're going to pay half of everything?
Yes.
So let me ask you this. Prior to you moving in, did you guys discuss that?
No. No, I thought in my mind, I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to be a stay-at-home mom. This could be fantastic. No, that was not the case. I moved in. You know, I had a good job. I worked in HR, you know, and it became 50-50. I'm thinking, okay, I'll pay out with half the bills, utilities, and help out with food. No, it was straight up half, pay half the mortgage, half the utilities, half of everything. And I'm like,
now, what does this expose about her, Sabrina? Her initial intention was to betanize him. What I mean, even though during the duration of the call, she said it wasn't actually a financial investment, but it really was. It was for the betterment of her. And so when I called it out on the call, they formed it as, well, we're being attacked. But no, you was actually being exposed. You see, there's a difference. See, her intent was to come in, still work, keep all of her money for herself, live in his house, which now becomes her house, as she so appropriately stated, and then open up a daycare in his house, which is now her house, according to her own words. And then when she finds out, because she didn't sit down and have an intelligible conversation with the man based, you know, on what she expected. Like, I expected to actually be paying nothing. Maybe I'll pay the utilities, which is only going to be a couple hundred a month, and help out with the groceries, but I don't want to pay the mortgage, but I still want to own half of this house, which she did by marrying him, right? So I warn men to watch out for these sort of traps, right? You're being betanized. You're being betanized because if you already have something, she comes into it, what gives her a right to leave with half of your property when she had nothing in regards to you actually owning that property because you previously owned that? So I raised the question during the duration of the call, what exactly does it profit a man by signing a marital agreement? And not one woman could actually answer that question, because it really doesn't profit the man. It always hurts him. It's a contract of his financial demise if the relationship ends in a divorce, which 50% of marriages do. 60% of second ones do. You decide. Judge wisely.
And I'm like, God damn, that was a lot, right? But I was used to doing it by myself, right? So what is splitting half? But then as you grow with this person and you have time, in my mind, I'm like, okay, I'm tired of playing 50-50. Like, my 50% should be if I'm already working a full-time job, I'm already being, a provider for your girls and my girls. I'm cooking, cleaning, doing the laundry, going shopping, making sure everything is taken care of, but you just have to go to work. And yes, he takes care of the outside of the house and mows the lawn and all that. So it's just like, I don't know how to explain it, but
she knows how to explain it, but she doesn't want to explain it because her intent was to betanize the male. And so what I mean by that, once she's in, many women would take an alpha and betanize him. Now she, even though she's saying it's not for his substance, it really is. Because she's saying, because I'm doing these things, I shouldn't pay anything. I should just be able to take my money and do whatever I want with my money and stay here. Just stay here. Even though this man's children are not of the age that requires her to look after him. One of them's 18. And so they're not, she's not in a predicament that you really have to watch my children. In fact, to my understanding, her daughter is actually younger than his, right? So she came into this with some sort of intent to be able to profit off of him. And I tell all men, women only go into relationships that they could benefit from. I challenge any woman to prove me wrong, right? That's most women. Not all women that's already successful, right? But normally, there has to be some sort of investment in that relationship where she could benefit from. Otherwise, she's not interested. And to just smash anything that they were saying, this is the reason that women that consider themselves successful in the corporate world, they very seldom will deal with a man that makes less than them, because he doesn't have something that she would typically be interested in. Now, mind you, there are those females that are in a place where they're financially okay and say they use a man for penis appointments, right? But she doesn't really want to be in a committed relationship, so she sleeps around. She sleeps around because the only thing she wants are penis appointments. No real commitment. This is the type of society that we're living in.
But it's just, I'm just like, I feel like it's more, I'm giving more, you know? And then by the end of the day, I'm so tired. I don't want to be intimate because I'm freaking tired, you know? And so then by that time, you're just like, here, watch your little porn or watch show, take care of yourself because I'm tired, you know, and I don't mind. And I, at this point, like, we've been together so long, I'm just like, you know, I've phased out.
If you could set your emotions aside, and you could hear what I mean by her betanizing this guy. So now she's depriving him of sex and she's telling him to go and watch porn, but wants him to provide for everything. So as a form of punishment of her having to pay half of the bills, which was never previously discussed, she withdraws sex and tells him to watch porn.
You know, I phased out. I've phased out of my, you know, my way of thinking and being that kind of a person. Hold on a second. So it's definitely is a hard thing, you know, when you're trying to have, you know, a long-term relationship, but it's like you both have to end up coming to some kind of agreement. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So let me ask you, what do you think about this, Lee? Lee, are you there? Are you here with the sister said?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I'm here. Hi, guys. Well, I'm listening and I hear you. I forget what her name is, but I'm listening to that. I was married for 23 years.
Oh my gosh.
three grown children, and I also have three stepchildren.
Oh, wow.
All of his children, they were very small when we got together. And our situation is a lot different than yours, though. I mean, I was the one that took the initiative to get the kids and bring them into my life and spend time with them and get to know them. And it was a lot different. However, I do understand when you're saying that you've had that conversation over and over again. Mm-hmm. You've said it this way, you've said it that way, and no matter how you say it, it's just not computing. Or he will address it because he's tired of listening to you.
Right.
He'll address it, but he's addressing it at the moment and he's not addressing it and sticking to what he's saying. He'll go to work. You're the one that has to deal with the children. You're the one that has to deal with the, you know, dirty looks and snide remarks and, you know, sabotage is what it is. So I hear what you're saying, but I also hear the other side of it. He's not being the head of the household, because if he put his foot down, that's his house. Yeah, you got one that's 18, but they got a mother that they can go to. And if you're not abiding by my rules in my house, you can go live with your mother. And basically, that's it. That's all. That's my take on it.
What about you, Anna? What's your take on this, Anna?
Honestly, I don't know because I'm not married and I don't have children. But I can like identify with Sabrina in some ways, just as far as like being in a relationship with someone who, you know, does identify as an alpha male. So I do live with my boyfriend. He invited me to come and stay with him. He makes 5-6 figures. He doesn't ask me to pay for any bills, but I do like take care of the house, meaning like cooking, cleaning, laundry, all of that stuff, like making sure that he's taken care of this way. But the thing is that I don't know, like I just feel like I can identify with the part where she's, you know, says that she feels a little like stuck or like burnt out, because I kind of feel the same way, like just coming home and taking care of somebody else. And I think my biggest issue, you know, just for my situation, is just identifying what I want, and B, like figure out what I need from him, because obviously if I'm pouring into somebody and I'm not getting the same reciprocation, and just figuring out what my next steps would be, if that makes sense.
You mean in your particular situation, or hers?
In my particular situation, because again, I can't identify with her. I'm not married. I haven't been with my partner for 8 years. I don't have any kids. So I don't really have any advice to give to her. So that's what I'm saying. Like, just listening to her situation is kind of a self-reflecting moment for myself.
So I want to ask everyone to reflect on this call and consider the male perspective here, right? As you see, each and every woman had a biased perspective against the man, or he's being abusive. Even the sister Anna used a term that was pretty harsh, by the way. But nevertheless, they never consider his perspective, that he's being compelled to decide between his wife and his children, which actually causes frustration. And I contend that his frustration was coming from, why can't they just get along? Why can't they just reach a happy medium? So him having to be that liaison to try and bring some sort of like harmony to the situation, it became frustrating. But the women are hearing something else. The women are hearing that, well, this guy is bad. He's not listening to her. She's trying to talk to him. Mind you, Lee was married for 23 years. Why did that marriage end in divorce? And she's up in age now. What's the probability of her getting married again? And so she'll probably say, I don't want to. Because it's a mindset you have to actually develop to survive these things. And so then you end up dying alone, miserable. Or you ever went in the woodshed and you saw an old shovel? When you go out, when you want to go out and till your garden, what is adjacent to that old shovel? You go and get that old hoe. How many of you want to use a old hoe? Why not go and get yourself a brand new one? Metaphorically.
And so a man that's truly a high value man is generally always busy. And so when he does have a little extra time, he wants to spend that time with someone of his choosing. And so if you're not there to do that, that kind of like creates some sort of tension. And then things, you know, they start to create work wives or work husbands and so on and so forth. Eliana just fell out. Where's Sharon?
Eliana fell out.
Yeah, I just said that. She just fell out. So yeah. Going back to Sabrina. Sabrina, you're in a place that you need to make a decision. Because I understand a man's like devotion to his children. But still, yeah, you got a man up. If what you're saying, because we're only hearing one side, so I can't really make a an intelligent decision only hearing one side. And just hearing Lee sounds a little biased to me, right? More swaying towards the female. I had the insight to be able to like really listen to people when they talk. And so it's making Sabrina out to be a victim when we haven't heard the other side. So it's not really rational to make an intelligible decision without hearing both parties. You understand what I'm saying? Because that could change things up. Because then there's her version, his version, and then there's the truth. So we can't really come to an intelligible conclusion until we've actually heard the total story, right? Because men and women, they look at things totally different. The man could come on and say something different. Women are usually coming from a place of emotions. Men are usually coming from a place of logic. Doesn't make sense to him. And so he's not feeling what she's feeling. So it looks like he's neglecting her needs. So you got to kind of like sit down and discuss that to really get clarity on that.
Can I say something real quick?
Sure.
I don't really consider I don't think that I'm biased. And because, like you said, I'm only hearing one side of a story. What I'm hearing is that she is trying to communicate. I think there is a communication breakdown between the boat, between the man and the woman. That's what I'm hearing. There's some type of communication breakdown. She's communicating, whether she's communicating on a level that he's understanding or he's just not listening. I don't consider it to be biased because I don't know both sides. I'm just hearing one side. That's all I have to say. Thanks.
Okay, I don't hear a communication issue here. What I'm hearing is that she's telling him, but from a man's perspective. I'm going to see it from a man's perspective. And so I believe that he's holding his children to a higher standard than he is his wife.
Yes.
That's what I'm seeing. Because I don't think he's not hearing it. Because she's saying, well, I sit down, I did that. I think that it's like, I hear you, but these are my children.
Right?
What if it's a case of he feels maybe he's damned if he does and he's damned if he doesn't? What if, like you said, maybe there's not a communication problem? Maybe he's afraid of what would happen if he does put his foot down too hard on the children. Is he going to lose his kids? Will he lose respect from his kids? Maybe there's something that he might be afraid of.
Well, if that was the case, he would have never stood up for her in that instance that she said, which leads me to my next question, Sabrina. In what instance did he stand up for you exactly? And did you compel him to do that, or did he do that off his own will?
So what happens is every Mother's Day comes around, and it was hell, right? Like, it just sucked for me. My daughter, biological daughter, obviously celebrated with me, and she, you know, felt bad or feels bad every time Mother's Day comes around. And this one particular time, it was just out, became disrespectful, like no acknowledgement. And I'm not expecting like gifts and flowers and anything like that, but just like, hey, happy Mother's Day. That's it. It would have been cool, right? But it didn't happen. And Leroy, or my husband, finally got upset and said, hey, you guys need to show some respect, you know, towards her. She does a lot, blah, blah, blah. And then it turned into this huge fight, and they ended up moving out because he stuck up for me. And that was a crazy night. And they moved out for a year, and they moved back, and everything was okay for the first few months. And then it became another situation in the home, a hostile, uncomfortable in your own home type situation. And then I had to make a decision whether I should stay or leave. And I told him, I'm not going to make you choose between me and your kids. Your kids are going to get older and have their own families. And I'm supposed to be here with you, living the rest of my life out with you. But right now, I need to take care of, I need to love myself before anybody else right now. Because if I don't, I'm going to suffer. And I ended up moving out with my daughter. And then that was the 2 months I was gone. And then you know, I realized, yes, we do love each other, care about each other. Let's try to work it out again, you know. But it is hard for him to talk to his older daughter. They have a different kind of relationship, and, you know, she had her own mental health issues happening. So I think that's in the back of his mind to make sure that she's okay. And I don't know what the fuck, to be honest. I'm just like, oh my God. And to make it even crazier is that I have a business inside my home, or in our home. So it is like I feel trapped. So, because, you know, it's a big situation. And, you know, I have my own space, you know, where I've created in a different part of the house, you know, but it feels like a family, but a divided family living under one roof.
So let me ask you this, Sabrina. What was his direct response when they moved out as a repercussion of him standing up for
He was pissed. He was pissed because he felt he was in the middle.
He was pissed
felt
at
he
who?
Had to choose
was,
between his kids and his wife. He
yeah,
felt
pissed
fucked
at
up.
Who?
He was pissed at who?
Him, everybody. Me, his kids, that he was in this situation, that it caused, you know, this big situation that didn't need to be. You know, and the thing about it, he's like, you know, I hated my stepdad too and all this. And I'm like, you know what? You hated your stepdad because he was fucking you up, messing up your mom, and hitting you up with heroin. So yeah, you have good reason. I'm not doing any of that to your kids. I'm not abusing them. I'm trying to love them. I'm trying to, you know, have a good home for them. And it's just not what I thought.
So once you were, because it seems like you already suspect that, you know, he feels like he's in this predicament of choosing between you and his children. So why didn't you confront him in that regard?
I have. We've gotten into several very heated, long conversations and arguments, and it just ends up not working out.
Can I just say, it sounds like he has some sort of like underlying trauma that he hasn't healed from have like all of these like lash out moments.
Yeah.
Did you guys Kador, like
you're, Kador, you're not involved. So why do you say that, Anna?
It just sounds like a pattern. So if she addresses anything or she sets off any of his triggers, it just causes him to act irrationally. So I don't know if they've ever had like any conversation like regarding that, or like if you've ever like tried to play therapist with him or anything like that, but it sounds like that's what you should do, maybe to see if he will open up and you have a little bit more insight, and then like you can learn how to, I don't know, navigate that situation. Because
he's very old school.
Yeah,
like the feelings, the like, you know, like the emotions, feel they don't, I don't care.
Okay, so I'm trying to grasp the concept of him acting irrationally. At what point does she say that? So give me an example. Cite your examples where he behaved irrationally.
Well, okay, so I'll take that word irrational back, but just like him just like lashing out or just like being mad.
Okay, so when did he lash out? So when did he lash out, Sabrina? Or she just fell off? So I must have missed it. So she said he lashed out?
No, from what I observed, was saying she...
So I want to ask everyone to reflect on this call and consider the male perspective here, right? As you see, each and every woman had a biased perspective against the man, or he's being abusive. Even the sister Anna used a term that was pretty harsh, by the way. But nevertheless, they never consider his perspective, that he's being compelled to decide between his wife and his children, which actually causes frustration. And I contend that his frustration was coming from Why can't they just get along?
She was more so saying like the time he took up for, he got a little upset because he was in between, you know, with that was a cause of the daughter's leaving for a year. But what I was observing and listening to is like, when she come back on, I wanted to ask her, like, what do she think that the issue with the daughter in herself starts or stems from? Because at the beginning I heard her say that the mom wasn't in their life, but then when they left for the year, they went and stayed with the mom.
The children are causing a division in the home. He's aware of that. Yep. You made him aware.
Yep.
You got to look at it from the factual point. If you was important enough, he would make that situation, if what you're saying is true, because we haven't heard his story. And the fact that he doesn't want to give it makes it unimportant, right? So we can only go based upon what you're saying. So if you're important enough to him, he would make that situation go away. So are you guys legally married?
Yes.
Okay. You need to issue some threats. You need to tell... No, I'm just telling him. Just keep it at 100. If he doesn't listen, tell him I'm going to divorce you and I'm going to take half of your shit.
And guess what? Well, let me tell you that. Let me explain this to you. So I did look into that. It got to the point where I did look at it and I called an attorney. It was about $5,000 to have a retainer. Right off. And... Yes,
you could file your own divorce. You don't need no retainer or any of that.
It takes a long time. And it's a lot of paperwork.
But
let me tell you this, though. It goes like this when you're a homeowner, right? So it's half. You get half the assets. You get half the house. You get half the debt. You get half the, the IRA and the his retirement. And when we talked about getting divorced, he's like, you are not getting a damn thing. And do you think I've worked this hard to make it where you get my retirement?
That's not up to him.
It'll be worse, I think.
Listen, thought over. They lose everything too. I'm telling you that the system is stacked against men.
So I got a question, Sabrina, real quick. You said he used to pay the mortgage and all his bills on his own. So
we've gotten together, we've accumulated, toys.
Right.
That together, and then he, did help me out with my schooling. So it's a big financial. Yeah.
It's not the same as
you. That's why I'm like, there's so many situations out there.
No, we're talking about Sabrina right now. So, Lee, are you still here?
I'm here. I'm just listening.
So hold on, Lee. We need your experience here from another woman's perspective, right?
Sure.
So, from what I'm hearing now, because things are slowly coming out here, I'm seeing it from a different perspective. So Sabrina pretty much now I'm starting to understand where a lot of this guy's animosity is coming from.
So as I begin to listen to Sabrina, and she made me more privy to what actually occurred, and I stopped disagreeing with her, the whole temperature of the call alters. Suddenly the females say, we're being attacked. Oh, this sounds like a Trump rally. Exacerbating pivotal points that was merely just, questions that was designed to reach a resolve. They're not really looking for a resolve. They're looking for one to agree with them. And you're never going to have a content relationship doing that. You have to look at your folly and address it. The inner me is the enemy.
So I say certain things that trigger certain, words to get people to spill their beans, right? And so I got her to talk. And as she talked, more started coming out, right? And so what it sounds like to me is that Sabrina used this guy to come up off of, like, she profited or for his, you know, having a house already. She didn't have her own home. She moved in with him. She started her own business. And it sounds like her business became profitable or for him. Now, the fact, think back. I need you guys to think back because I really listen to people when they talk. She profited over for him. And for her to actually have already done the things that I suggested means that she was planning an exit. She was planning to use this man to help her to leave this man, to help her establish herself, to help her career take off. She was planning to leave him, but when she found out that it wasn't going to be palatable, she decided to stay. So when she said that she really loved him, and I really don't buy that anymore.
Because she was talking about? Was
willing to leave. I didn't hear that.
What are you talking about? That is not at all.
Okay. I know what I heard.
Okay, hold on. You said it's not true. You're getting bored and you're making up stuff now.
No, hold on.
Okay, so she basically said that I was lying and said, let's run that back. She'd actually already went out, considered getting a divorce and see what she could actually take from this guy. And when she found out that it wasn't very palatable, she decided to stay there. Just listen.
Hold on. You said it's not true, right?
You're a homeowner, right? So it's half. You get half the assets. You get half the house. You get half the debt. You get half the, the IRA and the his retirement. And when we talked about getting divorced, he's like, "You are not getting a damn thing. And do you think I've worked this hard to make it where you get my retirement?"
That's not up to her.
It'll be worse, I feel.
Listen, thought over. So, are you guys legally married?
Yes.
Okay. You need to issue some threats. You need to tell. No, I'm just telling. Keep it at 100. If he doesn't listen, tell him I'm going to divorce you and I'm going to take half of your shit.
And guess what? Well, let me tell you that. Let me explain this to you. So I did look into that. It got to the point where I did look at it and I called an attorney. And it was about $5,000 to have a retainer, but like right off, right? And yes, you could
file
half,
your own divorce. You don't need no retainer or any of that.
It takes a long time. And it's a lot of paperwork. And
let me tell you this, though.
It goes like...
Hold on, you said it's not true, right? Did you have the business before you moved in with this guy?
I had a lot of businesses.
No. Now you're playing semantics. What business I'm talking about. Now you're starting to lie. Because I listened to what you were saying. You just admitted to me. You guys go back and listen to this call. You just admitted to me that you did not have the business until you moved into his house. Did you not say that?
I did not have this business. I had my business at another location. So my business was already up and running, right?
I specifically asked you a question.
You asked
Jadir, did you hear the question that I asked you? Kadar, did you hear the question?
Yeah.
But she loves her husband.
Hold on one second. He specifically asked her, did she have the business prior to moving in with the man? And she stated no.
Sorry, I misunderstood what you were saying. I had the business already, but I had a preschool already, right, at a different location with a friend. Then I did a second location, which is this location in my home. So I started a new business here in my home.
If you're getting to the point of it.
Because she started tap dancing once I caught on, like, well, hold on.
This is what I'm saying, Lisa.
And I know you guys understand it. You guys don't want to hear it, but I caught her.
Hold on.
She profited off of this man.
Profited?
She came up with,
I pay half the bills here.
Listen, I don't care about that. I don't care.
Listen, I couldn't tell.
Let's keep some composure here, right? Listen, let me explain something.
Hold on,
Sabrina. Show some decorum. You said you pay half of the bills, right?
Suddenly, every woman on the call gets amnesia and can't remember what it means to show decorum, show respect, and not talk over the host. So things become very disrespectful right here because I start disagreeing with her, right? And things starts to really turn left. And eventually, one by one, they all start leaving a call once the folly is exposed.
Yes, I do.
Hold on. Check this out right here. If you... hold on. Let's say I own an apartment, right? You come in and you pay... I'm telling you that you got to pay this every month. And so... because you're paying this every month, do you own my damn apartment? Are you telling me you get a share of my apartment? No, so what that man told you was you're paying for your half for staying here. It's making more sense to me now. So he said, well, you're gonna pay half. You said that initially when you came in.
Yes, I am paying half.
So you was only paying for your space, but it's still his place, right? Does a place have your name on it?
Yes,
it is your place.
And this is what I need men to deeply reflect on, and women that really want the truth. This man owned a house before he got involved with this woman. She made no sort of payment towards the mortgage whatsoever, right? Until she came in much later. He's already in this place. He's already been living there before she ever comes in, right? Raising his daughters. She comes in and she attempts to betanize him by verbally saying with her mouth, I don't want his substance. It was all about love. But again, I reiterate, it's not what they say, it's what they do. So what she was doing is saying, hey, this is half of mine now. I'm here now. Doesn't matter if you owned it already. And that is not beneficial to the man. Now he's been betanized and he set himself up for failure by way of a marital contract.
50-50 in a relationship. I took because it to a whole different other subject.
We are observing the
because I'm listening. Because I'm listening to the whole story.
Okay. All right.
So what I heard from this story, Sabrina, is that you came in, you profited off of, you stored it. See, you didn't have the property outside of the home to have stored that daycare. You used this home to store that daycare. So that means...
No. So let me tell you, let me tell you something. We've been together 8 years. I think if I wanted to profit or wanted to use him, I would have started it from the jump. Okay. Why am I waiting down the line to do that?
Hold on. Okay, so let me refresh your memory.
Why am I
because
wasting
most people
all
do
that
selective
money?
Listening, and I don't. Right? Let me refresh your memory. Oh yeah, I try to leave, but it's really hard out there.
I did.
I was paying almost $3,000 a month.
$3,000 a month. Come.
Do you realize our bills right now are about $500?
You could have started your own. So which is it? It's difficult out there. I don't want to pay you $3,000 a month. So imagine this, Kadar. Think. If she was paying the $3,000 a month plus the daycare.
You know what?
I haven't heard her say that word once.
If he was not, let me tell you this. If he was broke and it was just me and him, I totally would still be with him. Or like love him. I love him. We have a lot of fun together.
Yeah, you're talking to the wrong guy about that. Yeah.
You're not
going
to
That's a complete lie.
Okay.
What you talking about, Sabrina?
No, I've asked that question before, and she said I would be with him.
Listen.
That's true.
Most women don't know what they want. And I'm going to tell every woman on this call, but if that man went broke, she would not stay with that man. even though she may be consciously stating that now, she will not remain with that man. You think things are bad now? They will get 20 times worse.
But you know what? I've that been with people who had money. I've been with people who had money.
But you was just complaining about paying $3,000.
Yeah, because it's a lot.
So now what? So what if he's broke? Nah, man.
I got one question for you, Sabrina.
What's that?
What's your age range? You don't have to give. You don't have to say that again.
I said, when is this going to be over? Just kidding. Okay, what did you say?
On the spot.
What's your age range? You don't have to give an exact.
40. I'm 44.
Okay, I was going to say between 40 and 45. Okay.
Yep, 44, and I've lived
come a long way.
Yeah,
and that's know. Like a real know. Punk move. That's something so small.
It's not a punk move.
Let me explain. If you are opening up a big corporation employ 25 people.
Hold on, Lisa. You gotta show some
catering company or something.
You have a real problem with showing decorum, right? By talking over.
I'm just saying, that's so small. She's handling it very demure, very mindful.
Okay, well, let me be nice and calm. Let me calm down.
No,
you're handling it demure.
It's called lack of fathering. Women that's been reared by their fathers appropriately, they know how to interact with other men. They show respect.
Okay, Vance, you're sounding like Vance. This you're taking it back to the
okay.
That was a fact. It's a fact. No, it's not. You see the mind? You see when a man's having a problem with her?
Okay, but it's becoming more and more apparent. You said if she opened up a daycare, she should have a contract in place stating that.
No, I said he should have. He should.
No, he did it because he believed in me and he loved me. No, that's why. Yes.
No, he didn't because he was a weak man. That could possibly end up a victim, because I'm gonna say this. I'm gonna say this to you, and I'll say this to any female or male on the call.